And thank you for all being here today. I have the privilege and pleasure of introducing one of my fellow Pacific Council directors, the Honorable Michael Camuñez. More importantly, Michael has been a friend and colleague of mine for more than 25 years, and I promised him I would stick to the script and not start telling anecdotes about our times together. Michael is uniquely well-suited to lead today's discussion of the U.S.-Mexico relationship. As president and CEO of ManattJones Global Strategies, he oversees a preeminent business advisory firm that counsels global companies on doing business in Mexico.
Thank you.
He's also a former Assistant Secretary of Commerce and was a key architect of the U.S.-Mexico High-Level Economic Dialogue, the principal platform by which the U.S. and Mexico manage economic competitiveness and trade issues, and I'm sure we'll hear more about that today. Finally, Michael is the chair and founder of the Pacific Council's Mexico Initiative, of which today's keynote session is a part. So through the initiative, the Council informs public discourse on the U.S.-Mexico relationship. And before I turn the floor over to Michael, I just want to say a special word of thanks to his firm, ManattJones Global Strategies, for their support of the Mexico Initiative and for the conference. So please join me in welcoming to the stage Michael Camuñez, Ambassador Jacobson, and Ambassador Sada.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Since we're talking about Mexico, buenas tardes. Art, thanks for that kind introduction. It was exactly as I wrote it. Appreciate that. Now, actually, Art and I have been friends since we were both, I think, about 22, 23 years old, working to create and then pass the AmeriCorps program under President Clinton, which was a lot of fun. And it's been great to work with you over the years, Art, and to have your friendship. Thank you all for being here. It's really, you know, I think it was Secretary Cantor last night who said it was really fun to have the privilege to introduce friends at an important convening like this, and that really resonates with me today because, boy, if every day were like this, what a fun life and fun job it would be. Before I call up our distinguished panelists, I want to just take a quick second to tell you a little more about the Mexico Initiative and why we're doing it. And I think it's been said well. Jerry very articulately and persuasively made the case, but. Since we are, after all, in Los Angeles, which has the largest concentration of Mexicans outside of Mexico, same can be said of many countries and their expats, but there's a very special relationship between Mexico and Los Angeles and California generally. Mexico is not only our neighbor, we share deep heritage, history, language, culture, and trade and commerce. And that latter part of the relationship is often not well understood, much less articulated in the press or otherwise. But the fact of the matter is Mexico is, as you'll hear on the panel today, not just another trading partner. It is truly a strategic partner of the United States, without whom, frankly, I seriously question whether Detroit would be back. We're so proud of our auto industry. We have former directors of GM and others in the room. Arguably, Detroit would not be as resurgent as it is without the important contribution that the Mexican economy has made. And we can go on and on, and perhaps we'll get into some of those. But the fact of the matter is, the Pacific Council is here in Los Angeles. Mexico is just to our south. It's an important neighbor. And we wanted to do something to really bring the Pacific Council back to its roots as the Pacific Council to be a preeminent thought leader on the U.S.-Mexico, U.S. Western Hemisphere relationship, which is frankly a relationship that doesn't get nearly enough attention, even in Washington and Mexico City. And so it's really terrific that I can say with great pride that our co-chairs and the entire board have been extremely supportive of the initiative. We launched it earlier this year. We had our first very successful event. Over 200 people attended the U.S.-Mexico Economic Outlook, which we partnered with the U.S.-Mexico Chamber of Commerce on. It was a fantastic event downtown. Many of you were there. This is the second signature big event we have with the two ambassadors. All of you on your chairs or on your table should see this Mexico Initiative flyer. I want to call to your attention the fact that we have, and tell you a little bit more about what we have planned, next spring in May. These dates are pretty final, but hopefully we'll be able to confirm them once we've collaborated a bit more with the government. We plan a high-level delegation visit to Mexico City. It's going to be a fabulous trip. I'm going to lead the delegation, and I'm going to personally set the trip up and make sure, with the ambassador's help, the two ambassadors' help, that it is a outstanding visit, and we want to present to you the real face of Mexico. We're going to be establishing a non-resident senior fellowship where we'll bring Mexican scholars, some of whom from perhaps Mexico and other parts of the country, some of whom here in the United States. We have one right here, Pamela Starr, a preeminent Mexican scholar at USC, who I have the privilege of working with every day. But we want to create thought leadership and scholarship coming out of the Pacific Council on the U.S.-Mexico bilateral relationship. And we're also going to be looking to increasing significantly our programming around Mexican issues, the U.S.-Mexico relationship. When I was in Washington last week with the ambassador at the AEM summit, which brought 250 Mexican businessmen to Washington, I was speaking with the ambassador and with his team about the fact that the Mexican Secretary of the Economy has never been to Los Angeles, and we're going to write that. We're going to fix that and bring him early in the year and hopefully to the Pacific Council as part of our Mexican initiative. So, Mexico initiative. So with that said, please, we'd welcome your involvement. We're going to create a working group that's going to help sustain and drive the programming, and we'd welcome your support in every way. And I just want to make sure you take a look at this and stay connected with us. Without further ado, let me ask Ambassador Sada and Ambassador Jacobson to join me on stage, and I'll introduce them from there. Neither of these incredibly distinguished diplomats really need much of an introduction. You have their bios, but I have to say, as a point of personal privilege, how fun it is to introduce them, because what you have in front of you are perhaps two of the most distinguished diplomats in both the United States and Mexican history. I mean, that's a bit of an overstatement, but when you hear about some of the things they've done, at least in the context of the U.S.-Mexico relationship, these folks have been incredible leaders in this space, and there really haven't been, I hate to say, I'm sad to say, a lot of people that can claim that mantle. Let me start with Roberta Jacobson, who has spent more than 30 years in the State Department, and you laughed when I said one of the more distinguished diplomats, but let me tell you, Roberta has had an incredible career. I had the privilege of working with her. We were counterparts when she was Assistant Secretary of State for the Western Hemisphere, and I was Assistant Secretary of Commerce. The first woman to lead the Western Hemisphere Bureau in the history of the State Department. How about that? Roberta has risen through the ranks working as a civil service officer, right, which if you understand State Department politics, how hard it is to achieve the kind of leadership she has attained as a civil service officer, not as a foreign service officer. She's led the Mexico desk. She's held virtually every position imaginable as deputy chief of mission and a couple of very important embassies. She was deputy assistant secretary, then principal deputy assistant secretary, then assistant secretary.
Finally gave me the time.
And that most importantly, during her tenure as Assistant Secretary for the Western Hemisphere, as Jerry alluded to, and has been well documented in national publications like Time Magazine, The New York Times, and elsewhere, she was really the president's point person negotiating the normalization of relations with Cuba. And that is a historic achievement that will go down in the books as something that we really need to thank her for. As we'll talk about, Roberta and I also worked on U.S.-Mexico relations and establishing the high-level economic dialogue. We traveled with the president to establish that back in 2013. And I have to say, I cannot think of a better qualified person to serve as our country's representative. I am hoping for Hillary Wynne. That's not a person. That's not a Pacific Council endorsement. That's a statement in favor of Roberta Jacobson's continued tenure as our ambassador. And I hope, Roberta, that we'll see you there for many years to come as our ambassador. Welcome to Los Angeles, and we hope this will not be the last time you're here. Carlos Sada, who is, as Jerry said, our hometown guy, is on the Mexican foreign ministry side one of Mexico's truly accomplished and distinguished diplomats. He began his career as mayor of the city of Oaxaca in the state of Oaxaca in the south of Mexico, understands retail local politics. Let me tell you, Oaxacan politics are tough. Was a very accomplished mayor and then joined the Mexican foreign ministry and has risen through the ranks and has held, if there were a NAFTA, if there were a poster for a NAFTA champion, a NAFTA diplomat, in chief. I think it would have to be Ambassador Sada. He has served in Canada, in Toronto. He served in Washington. He was the liaison for the Mexican government to the U.S. Congress when the NAFTA deal was being negotiated. He has served at the United Nations. He has served in virtually every important consulate post. The Mexican government is a true leader in having 50 consulates across the United States. And Los Angeles is by far the largest and most important. And let me make sure I don't forget to acknowledge Ambassador Carlos Garcia de Alba, who's here, the new Consul General. The ambassador has just returned from being ambassador to Ireland on behalf of Mexico. We're delighted to have him here in Los Angeles. But back to Ambassador Sada, he has really been an outstanding champion as Consul General in all of the major cities, and most recently in Los Angeles. Welcome home, Mr. Ambassador. It's a delight.
Thank you.
It's wonderful to have you. So let's get into it. I'd like to ask Ambassador Sada, you, if you'd set the stage for us. You know, really the first question I have is, why Mexico? You know, I can say why it's important. Others can say it, but set the stage for us. Give us maybe a bit of a perspective from your time as a diplomat and how you've seen Mexico evolve economically from a, you know, single commodity emerging economy to the reality that we see today, which is a true global economic powerhouse.
First of all, muy buenas tardes, as we said in Spanish. And I'm so delighted and thrilled to be here participating in this unique panel and with so many friends from different groups, institutions, organizations of Los Angeles. And I want to really praise the role of Jerry as the chairman, because since the very first moment that we met, we started talking about what to do regarding Mexico, neighbor to the south of the United States, because there is the perception that even though we are neighbors, partners, and friends, we do not know each other so well. And the Pacific Council has been so unique. We put together a group of consul generals in order to form a kind of a group that would be continuously presenting different aspects of what we do as representatives of our countries. And in particular, of course, we started talking about the Mexico Initiative. And we were so fortunate that Michael moved from DC to Los Angeles. And so we started going more into details on how to really trigger the interest for Mexico. Not to take it just for granted. And that made me, gave me the possibility of learning more about the relationship, but more importantly so, to meet so many actors and protagonists that are here. And here in this room, we have a good number of experts, the relationship with Mexico, but perhaps some other needs a little more of information in order to have the real importance and relevance of what Mexico is about in relationship with the United States. So when a lot of friends told me, bienvenido a casa, welcome home, I really feel so honored to be here in Los Angeles and to be welcome with that phrase. Bienvenido a casa for us is a lot. And yes, I'm now the representative of Mexico to Washington, but I'm also a diplomat that it is praising so much and promoting the relation of California with Mexico and Los Angeles with Mexico, because it is something that has to be put as an example in many fronts that we do not really know. And when there is people from other states, they become a little jealous. And sometimes they say, well, the problem is that California is eating our lunch. He says, well, that's not what I mean. But what I mean is that the relationship between California and Mexico, it is unique, and I'll come back to this statement later on. But yes, I was Consul General of Mexico in Toronto because if you see my background, I'm not a traditional diplomat. I'm an engineer. I was in politics, and then I was invited to join Foreign Service starting in Toronto. At that time, it was when NAFTA was put on the table. It was back in 1989, 1994. And when we arrived, Mexico arrived to the table, as you recall well. At that time, there was just an agreement between the United States and Canada, and Mexico was not there. So it was the intention and the interest of President Salinas at that time to join this partnership. And in Toronto, as you well know, it is one of the most important states regarding industry and international projection. So it was important to be there. And we started negotiating with the local authorities and with business people. We were not, to be very honest, very welcome, because all of a sudden Mexico was in the table also, trying to have a close relationship with the United States and with Canada. So it took a long time. Long time. It was not as long as it took for the U.S. to negotiate the agreement with Canada. But still, we had to maneuver a lot. You remember, perhaps, that after NAFTA was signed, there were elections in Canada. And you know what was the result of the election? I don't want to... Actually, Mr. Mulroney had a very hard impact because it was not that popular. It was not because of that only. But Mexico managed to negotiate with the country. At that time, Mexico was not a player in the international scenario regarding trade. The trade between the two nations, it was only $80 billion, 80. Now it is $570 billion. In a very short period of time, here we have Mexico that grew along with the United States and Canada in this very unique free trade agreement. That was the first one that was put together between two nations and one less developed nation. And it has been the model of a lot of trade pacts that were designed afterwards. At that time, it represented, and this is something that I want to emphasize, it represented like approximately 19% of world trade. Nowadays, even in spite of that amount that I mentioned to you, it represents 15%, 14%. So we are losing ground. Some people say, well, it is because the pie is bigger. But my reflection is, it doesn't matter. We are also getting bigger and bigger, so we need to be more aggressive in that sense. Because on the other hand, Asia trade represents 36%. It used to represent at that time, I'm referring to year 2000, 28%. And what happened in between? A lot of things have happened. But nowadays, and I'll go back with some additional numbers, nowadays, Mexico is the second largest trading partner of the United States. And we cannot conceive what is happening nowadays. When I go and visit a lot, a congressman, because I have that bias from my previous job in Washington, it is so interesting. When you mention some of them, the first reaction is, yes, but we need to have a safe border. And I'll come to the border. We'll come to the border. Says Mr. Congressman or Senator, do you know how many people crosses the border every single day? Well, it is 1 million people crossing the border every day. Somebody says, well, because we are afraid of terrorists. He says, well, yes, so are we. And we are the ones that want to have that border flawless. But never has happened that a terrorist comes to the border. So it's pretty safe border in general.
Carlos, we'll come back to the border. Let me ask you to focus, if you will, a little bit on the 20 years since NAFTA. We're going to talk specifically about NAFTA. But some of the structural, give the audience a sense. I think my sense, one of the challenges Mexico faces, is that the average American doesn't appreciate how much Mexico has changed in the last 20 years. And Roberta, I'd like your take on this also. And it's not just NAFTA. It's because of some important work Mexico has done internally. So if you could give us just quickly a sense of the kinds of reforms that Mexico has pursued in the last 20 years and the results that's led to. And then, Roberta, I'd like to come to you and ask you from your perspective, having seen this relationship evolve over the last 30 years, what are the big changes that you've seen?
People think that it was just a commercial pact. Mexico has been transformed from different fronts. Our democracy has been very consolidated. Not a lot of people know that we already had two presidents that are from a different political party, from Partido Acción Nacional, right-wing party, and there are numbers of governors and mayors from different parties. So we consolidated our democracy. And now we have opened to the world. It is one of the five most open economies, but also we are under the scrutiny of a lot of international institutions that permanently supervise what we are doing, including human rights, and we'll talk about it later on, and including, of course, the compliance with the rule. That is so important, and perhaps I'll stop here a little bit and pass the word to Roberta.
So I think one of the things that's most interesting in the years, almost 23 years since NAFTA, is first the things that NAFTA didn't do, which it never was going to do. And I think many of us recognize that in some respects NAFTA was oversold. It was presented as if it could make all of the economic, political, social, demographic changes that we wanted to see both in the relationship and in Mexico itself, as if a free trade agreement took care of all of that. In fact, it never could, any free trade agreement, certainly not this early version of a free trade agreement. What we have seen in the 20-something years is, as Penny Pritzker said yesterday, a six-fold increase in trade, which is what free trade agreements are designed to do. What didn't happen until very, very recently was a series of structural reforms in Mexico, which had to accompany NAFTA for Mexico's economy to fundamentally change and move Mexico really leaps and bounds ahead. Even without those structural changes, what you've had in the 20 years is the change of Mexico to a largely middle-class country. But you've also had a situation in which I think Ambassador Sada and I probably agree there are at the very least two Mexicos, northern and southern, and possibly more than that in terms of income level, development level, infrastructure, et cetera. Southern Mexico being significantly poorer than northern Mexico. But in the last four and a half years of this president, and beginning earlier under the two PAN administrations, you have a series of economic and political reforms that really fundamentally changed Mexico and are still underway in their implementation. Recently, what you had were labor reform, fiscal reform, energy reform, telecommunications reform, opening up all of those systems and modernizing Mexico's structures to make Mexico much more able to compete. And from my perspective, one of the most important begun under President Calderon with an eight-year time frame, which is really very, very short, a new criminal justice system which moves Mexico from an inquisitorial written system left by the Spanish to an oral adversarial system similar to the U.S., which opens the entire judicial system to more transparency, to greater citizen participation, greater protections for defendants, and will have a dramatic effect eventually on both criminal law as well as civil law and the effects on investment and a level playing field for investment. So I think when you look at where Mexico has come, what you see is at the very beginning, immediately post-NAFTA, you really only saw half the job done in terms of the change of Mexico to become more competitive, more developed as its two other NAFTA partners. And you've had the rest of that work be done over the past 22 years, and really a good bit of it in a rush in the last few years, which has had a very dramatic effect on Mexican society, Mexican economic development. You now have whole areas of Mexico which have enormous amounts of foreign investment in automotive industry, in aerospace, in high technology, and the growth of entrepreneurship, which the infrastructure and the regulatory structure and the legal structure is basically catching up to support. But I don't know that the perception of Mexico, especially in the United States, has necessarily kept up with the reality of a new Mexico.
And that's kind of what I want to drill down on, especially with this audience, before we move on to NAFTA and the border and other things, is you look at Mexico circa 1980 and before, where you had truly a petroleum exporting, a single commodity market. You didn't have an independent central bank. You had a one-party control, an authoritarian regime that had been in power since the Mexican Revolution, almost 80 years or so before. And in this short time span, I'm always amazed when I take friends or clients to Mexico, to different pockets, to Querétaro, to Monterrey, to different parts of Mexico, even outside of Mexico City. They're blown away by what they see. They're like, this is Mexico. How did it achieve that, Carlos? What kinds of, I want you to paint a modern picture of the reality of the modern Mexican economy.
Tell you that when NAFTA came out, it was not very popular in Mexico. And now the perception is different because we have seen the impact of a pact like that. And Roberta mentioned, I always commented at that time that I saw not two, but three Mexicos. The Mexico of the South, Mexico of the Center, and Mexico of the North. Nowadays, I think we have two Mexicos, Central and North, and South. And that is why, and when people feel here that NAFTA hasn't been good, we also have to differentiate to whom and where. And the same, it's totally different story, but here, the central part of the United States, the Midwest, it is where there is more impact because of losing manufacturing jobs, not because of NAFTA, but because of technology and so on. But at that time, also, there was a transformation during this time of Mexicans. We needed really to adapt to the new world and to compete. And that's what Mexico did. We first joined the WTO, and then we decided to join NAFTA. I remember, perhaps you met Herminio Blanco. Herminio Blanco was a former Secretary of Trade of Mexico. And when China was about to join WTO, he was asked by one of the very important personalities of the business world here, what do you think of China, Mr. Blanco, joining WTO? And are you afraid of that? And his answer was, we are not afraid. We are in panic. And that was true. That time, investment started going, when China got in, going to China instead of to our region. But after 10 years, we readapted again. And we did our job regarding finances of Mexico. And we had a change of mentality. And we decided by ourselves that we had to continue becoming more and more global. And what we have now, believe it or not, is a Mexican society, Mexican businessmen that are very global. They are thinking of what else to do. That's why it is not that we are defending NAFTA. What we are proposing is to join TPP, because it is a consequence of NAFTA. And if we want to continue competing in the world, we need to continue being aggressive. Only when we were in Washington with these businessmen of the Mexican Business Association, there were five or six CEOs of Mexican corporations, Mexican business, very well structured, that are investing here. And they are investing in India. They are investing in China. And when Mexico relationship with the U.S. is analyzed, and you realize that there is approximately 5 million jobs that have been created in the United States because of NAFTA. That is something that really draws the attention. And now Mexican businessmen becoming more aggressive into the U.S. market, it is additional jobs being created here. So what I feel is that we need to continue thinking as a region. The worst mistake that we can continue making is that to see that we are fighting with each other for jobs. It is we are fighting with the rest of the world. And this is something that has to be permeated and not distorted, because that generates very negative reactions both in the United States and Mexico.
Yeah, I want to talk a little bit about the idea of North America and North America as a platform. But let's talk a little bit about NAFTA. Donald Trump, I'm going to say the word, has campaigned using Mexico effectively as a punching bag in his race, not just baiting voters with nativist language and racist language, but on the economy. He has said, quote, NAFTA is the single worst trade agreement ever negotiated, and is, you know, he doesn't exaggerate very much, but in his understated way. So I want to ask, we have two experts here on the NAFTA agreement. You know, Roberta, you know, is NAFTA a failure? And if not, defend it. Defend why NAFTA has worked for the United States and for Mexico.
So I think the first answer to that question I sort of alluded to in the first answer. First of all, I do not think NAFTA has been a failure. I think NAFTA has been an overwhelming success. I think if you look at the trade numbers, they are part of the story. I think if you look at the growth in the diversity of our trade balance and the products we sell to each other and trade with the world, both of us together, you see a huge growth in the kinds of products we sell, the kinds of products we make, and the amount of products we sell. Similarly, what was pitched was a NAFTA that would turn Mexico into a middle-class country. The problem, in a sense, was it was supposed to happen overnight. Obviously, that was unrealistic. On the other hand, we have a Mexico that is a majority middle-class country, slower than anyone would have liked, but will continue that process if we continue the process that NAFTA began, especially if, obviously, we focus on the secondary reforms and the rule of law focus. But I think the other thing that is very little understood, and I had one of those conversations on the plane coming here with Americans who have nothing to do with foreign policy or NAFTA or international trade, and we were talking about things like the aviation agreement that was just signed between the U.S. and Mexico and went into effect in August and took over a decade to negotiate, which is already opening up new routes between the U.S. and Mexico. Interjet just added two new routes to Chicago. We're going to have a lot of openings in new air routes between the U.S. and Mexico. You have a situation in which every dollar's worth of import into the United States from Mexico, products that come into the U.S. from Mexico, has 40% or 40 cents of U.S. content in it. That means content that's made in the United States. The equivalent amount of product that comes into the U.S. from China has 4 cents. So we're not just importing things from Mexico or exporting to Mexico. We're actually making products together.
Say more about that, Roberta, because that statistic is thrown around a lot, and I've come to believe that it's not well understood. When people hear that, they don't really appreciate what that means for American workers, for our own economic strength at home.
Right, and so what it means is every time, you know, something is produced in Mexico at the higher end, let's leave aside for the minute the auto industry, because I think the auto industry is actually better understood than most, right? We now have a North American automotive show, right? We no longer talk about U.S. automotive show, because every single car crosses the border multiple times and has inputs from the U.S., Canada, and Mexico. But if you talk about other forms of advanced manufacturing, whether it's aerospace or machinery, John Deere tractors, all sorts of other things, when you have finished products, electronics and other things, Sometimes it's things like garage door openers. It's things, it's other things that Americans don't think about. When that finished product is imported into the United States, people think of it as a Mexican product, QED, it is Mexicans taking away U.S. jobs. But in that product that is imported into the United States, 40% of the content of that product came from the United States from factories that are employing Americans. So every time a U.S. or other, could be French, could be Brazilian, you know, Embraer, or it could be other factories that open up in Mexico and often are producing advanced goods, they are very, very often part of a linked supply chain that is getting its content from the United States, keeping factories both open in the United States or opening factories in the United States to get that content. And one of the smartest economists I know in Mexico said years and years ago that ultimately what Mexico really had going for it, despite many of the sayings to the contrary, was actually geography. When Maquilas left to go to China, and as Carlos said earlier, Mexico decried the loss of that economic opportunity to China, many of them were back a few years later, whether it was IPR violations or the price of oil and transportation, or cultural differences that could not be surmounted. And so ultimately what Mexico and North America have to highlight is that with just-in-time manufacturing and improved infrastructure, which we've got to focus on, the three of us, that is what ultimately will make us much more competitive together and keep factories open and jobs created in all three countries, because you can get back and forth from Mexico into the United States in today's manufacturing processes much more easily than when you locate the factory in a rush to the bottom in a low-wage neighborhood. And obviously when oil was at $100 a barrel, that was a significant impediment. It's not at that anymore. And there are lots of people who talk about how Mexico perhaps was the unluckiest country in the world to open its oil industry and find oil then dropping to $25 a barrel. But over the long term, this is still an enormous opportunity for Mexico to be and stay in this North American neighborhood, much more competitive overall, and as I say, both retain industries that otherwise would have left permanently, and as that middle class grows and is sustained, become a much larger consumer base for the United States.
Carlos, President Trump would have the power to rescind NAFTA with 6 months' notice. What would that mean to the Mexican economy and to the North American, if not the world economy, if NAFTA were in fact rescinded? And what's the Mexican government doing to prepare for that contingency, if anything?
Well, I've been in my last 4 months since I'm ambassador, visiting several states. In order to grasp the feeling of what is happening there and what is the perception. And I meet with the governors, business people. In fact, the Secretary of Foreign Affairs and myself were in Milwaukee day after the visit of Mr. Trump to Mexico. We can go into details later. But opening the 50th consulate of Mexico. And it is again surprising as well, we have that figures, to learn how many businessmen are doing business, local business, with Mexico. And to let them know that out of the 50 states of the United States, between 33 and 34, Mexico is the number one or number two or three market for what they produce. So, and when you mention this to governors, some of them have the idea, others not necessarily, and that has not permeated. We need to understand that we have to have a different approach to that. Now, Mr. Trump and NAFTA is going to affect the two of us. So we are totally intertwined in our economies, as I was mentioning. And according to analysts of what might happen, it is not immediately that he can put a tariff of 35 or 40%. We can have to go back to the rules of the WTO. And in that sense, we will be entitled to put an additional tax of 7.9%, and the US only 1.7%. So starting with, we are going to be in the position of putting extra taxes to whatever it is exported to investors. And that we are going to lose competitiveness, the two of us. Of course, what we are doing is continue opening more possibilities for Mexican products. But it is not the Mexicans. It is products that are produced in Mexico. The last factory that was opened was Kia. Was a factory from South Korea that put $3 billion close to Monterrey. And it is not just because of NAFTA. It is because we have agreements with 46 countries in the world. So we are not just dependent on one. Of course, it's going to affect us a lot because almost 80% of our trade is with the United States. And that's why we are emphasizing that we should continue opening avenues for trade with TPP. What happens with TPP? It is that in the case of Mexico, we do not have an agreement with Australia or New Zealand or Japan. So we are trying to move closer to those markets. But anybody, any company that invests in Mexico, automatically they can export to 46 additional nations without almost any tariffs. So of course it's gonna be consequences, but not just for Mexico, and this is so important. Also last week, if you saw President of Mexico opening the Audi plant, from Germany, in Puebla, along with Volkswagen. So Mexico is attracting investment from different parts of the world. So it is not that this is something that we have to really have a very clear idea what is the real impact. And we are having another initial trade pact, which is a Pacific Alliance with Peru, Chile, Colombia, and Mexico. Panama is joining in, and Costa Rica almost for sure, and there is 40 more observers to this pact. So we decided to be open. We are very aggressive in the international scenario, and we are becoming more and more global. We are concerned, yes, because it's going to affect different fronts, but it's going to affect the two of us or the three of us. Canada is as concerned as we are because, of course, it is the number one export market from the United States.
So I'm getting lots of signals about time. We have to move to questions in a moment, but I'm going to invoke my moderator's prerogative because there's a couple more topics that I feel are really important that we get to. The Trump effect and the Trump issues, I'm sure people have lots of questions about Trump's visits. I was going to ask a few more questions about that, but let's move on. We tend to talk about, to the extent even we in the Mexico Initiative tend to talk about the Mexico partnership, we tend to talk in economic terms. There's obviously very other important components to the partnership that include cultural exchanges, the expat community in both countries. There's 1,000 Americans living in Mexico.
A million.
And there's thousands of American children who've been deported with their families.
600,000,
thank you. But there's a lot of rich nuggets to talk about, but I think we can't conclude without talking about the security relationship. Because so many Americans, as we continue to sort of think of Mexico in pejorative terms and use it as a political punching bag, or just don't get that offended when someone else uses it, we tend to forget that we share a 2,000-mile border with Mexico. And if you look at other borders in the world, like the Syria-Turkey border, the Pakistan-India border, the North Korea-South Korea border, I can go on, where countries that live in constant insecurity, we were talking about Israel this morning, because of the threat of violence from their neighbor, or if not from their neighbor, migration through their neighbor, like the European Union is dealing with right now with Turkey and the refugee crisis. We have had a history, other than the war that we initiated with Mexico, we've had a peaceful history with Mexico for over 100 years. Roberta, you can speak probably better than anybody to this from a security standpoint. I like to say, and I know Pamela Starr is a fan of this, America needs to wake up to the fact that Mexico has our back. in an age of security, in an age of terrorism, in an age of real risk of dirty bombs and other things that get snuggled in places, we are so fortunate to have the border that we do with Mexico. Tell us about the state of the security cooperation that exists. How much do we really depend on Mexico in that space? I think that's an important message for the audience to hear.
So Michael's answered a lot of this question positively, and I think it's incredibly important. One of the talking points that needs to be much louder and much stronger from the United States is that Mexico does have our back in a way that is very poorly understood. And it's misunderstood for a couple of different reasons, partly because it is not something that Mexicans have wanted to talk about very loudly. The notion that the Mexican government is doing an enormous amount to help secure the United States has not been something that has been politically popular in Mexico. And so it has not necessarily been seen as a positive thing, certainly positive in the United States for American sort of policymakers to talk about, but not necessarily sort of amplified by our Mexican colleagues. I think that's changed significantly recently. Second of all, when we look at incidents of sort of bad people coming across the border from outside the region, which is largely what we're concerned about other than drug traffickers who are from the region largely, whether it's Mexico, US, or elsewhere. Mexico, in their cooperation with the United States, has, as they look at thousands of people coming north to the United States, whether from Central America, South America, or elsewhere, they have detained, interviewed, returned, cooperated on hundreds and hundreds of what are euphemistically called special interest aliens who are from North Africa, from the Middle East, from other parts of the world, which we may have intelligence information on, they may have intelligence information on, and may be of law enforcement, military, or other interest to the United States. That cooperation is extraordinary. And unfortunately, the only public example of it recently was the Arbabsiar case, the Iranian who had the misfortune to talk to a DEA informant, which is almost a caricature of the seriousness of this kind of relationship. It is also true that obviously we collaborate very, very extensively on other cases, whether it's nuclear cooperation and other forms of weapons trafficking coming from the South North. Two other things I want to make the point about, since I worked on the Merida Initiative from its inception, its conception in 2008. One is that there are too many people, I think, who have preemptively decided that the Merida Initiative is a failure because violence has not ended and drug trafficking has not ended to the United States. I think the first thing that I would say is, number one, if we look at Plan Colombia and the extent to which our engagement with the Colombians has been successful, I don't think any of us had a good sense that it was going in the right direction for a decade or more. The second thing is, obviously, the U.S. spent over three times as much money in any one year in Colombia as we do in Mexico. Fact is, Mexico is an OECD country, has different resources they can extend to the problem, but it's nowhere near the same kind of a program in terms of U.S. involvement. But finally, I would say that there has been an incredible success of Merida and the initiative that we've had with Mexico in the one thing that is the hardest to achieve in some ways and the least visible, which is a habit of cooperation. 10 years ago, there was no such habit of cooperation between our security forces, our law enforcement agencies, our intelligence entities, and our governments in general. And today, it's extraordinary how they work together, keeping all of us safe on both sides of the border. And that just is something that takes years and years to achieve. The final thing I would say is that when you look at demand reduction and prevention, which this administration has put so much more funds into than its predecessors and was beginning to have real achievements on in areas like cocaine, you had the wave of new drugs overtaking that and the opioid crisis in this country, whether it was a resurgence of methamphetamine with new chemical composition, which overcame some of the restrictions that Mexico and we had put on it, or unfortunately, the opioid crisis with an epidemic of heroin now added to with the synthetic heroin drug fentanyl, which is anywhere from 22 to 50% more potent than heroin, which is often unknowingly put into heroin sales and therefore is killing as many as 200 or more people a week in some areas of the United States. That has had a devastating effect on both the U.S. and Mexico. The profit margin is much larger. And so we are confronting a challenge at this point that will test all of the structures we have put into place and all of our resources. And if there was anything that was ever a shared responsibility, this is it. And we need a major new campaign in this country to, if you will, denigrate the pleasure, the coolness, the importance of drugs like that, and try and increase the amount of danger and risk we portray it with, and also the damage it is doing to other countries as well as on the streets of some of our cities and towns if we're gonna try and overcome it.
Carlos, just quickly, if you would, a comment on that, then I wanna, if I don't turn to Q&A, I'm gonna be disinvited from ever being a moderator again.
No, I'm very impressed by the level of cooperation that we have, and I've been in the United States for a while. So I know how things keep moving and the degree of trust between each other. Roberta does every single day in Mexico, we do every single day in the United States, because we are together in this. We additionally have our southern border, which is very unique and different. You have to remember that Mexico is a country of regarded immigrants, of origin, of destiny, of transit, and of return. So these characteristics make Mexico unique. Right now, as we speak, we are negotiating with 5,000 plus people from Haiti that are in Tijuana, and they are coming all the way from Brazil because they were given visas in Brazil. So they move up to 7-8 countries, and the same is true with the people from Africa. And that we have to do our job at the southern border, but they are coming through because they want to come to the United States. So if we do not have a profound degree of cooperation, the two countries are going to be much more vulnerable. So this region is projecting a very safe environment, and that's why they are coming, and that's why they are staying in Mexico. The last thing that we did only a week ago is giving special working permits to Central American people for the Northern Triangle in order to come to Mexico to work for a period of time and then go back to their country the same way that we have with Canada. But the issue is that if you take immigration right now, only 30% of immigrants coming to the United States are from Mexico. The remaining 70% are from all over the world, mainly from Central America. But they are, most of them, crossing through Mexico or coming from other ways of coming to the United States. And this is something that, again, needs to have a very unique sense of cooperation. The Secretary of Homeland Security was in Mexico the last 3 days, having conversations with Secretaries of State and with the President of Mexico, because it is so important that we have agreements that work. Roberta was mentioning the issue of drugs. We do not produce cocaine yet. A lot of the cocaine comes to Mexico. We do not produce these chemicals that she was referring to, fentanyl. We do produce heroin, right? And we are under a lot of pressure because of the legalization of marijuana in the United States. And now there is the other way around. It's been exported from here to there. And today there was an article very interesting of a letter to Mr. Kerry, in the sense, not from Mr. Kerry, to the United Nations, in trying to ban these chemicals that are coming from China and other parts of Asia through the United States, through Mexico, again here. So what I want to put in perspective is the degree of complexity that exists between our two nations. And in order to be safe, we need to continue collaborating. I'm not going to go into the Mayor Initiative. I have my own personal opinion, right, that in general.
But I think you said it well, Carlos, and that's where I want to end, is that, you know, we tend to sort of look at Mexico through a single prism in this country, and it's easy to vilify and demonize and really misjudge the extent of dependency, whether it's economically, from a security standpoint, or otherwise. Let's turn to some questions here. I know we've got several, and let me just scan the room here. Yes, sir.
We have mics.
Yes, there are mics. Please tell us who you are and your question.
Hi, my name is Alex Michelson. I have a question about Donald Trump. What do Mexicans really think about him and what's going on in this country? And has his language created challenges for you as diplomats? And do you have any insight of his, about his visit there? Any interesting stories you can share with us?
Well, I think it is clear what the opinion of Mexico is about Mr. Trump. And if you read the newspapers, That's exactly what is the feeling of the Mexican community. But there is additional negative effects that Mexico and the U.S. Have been working for 30 years or so with this trade agreement that we've been mentioning. And it was not easy to position the image of America in Mexico, and it's been improving and improving and improving. And nowadays, it is more popular, the United States and Mexico, than Mexico and the United States. But this issue of Trump, it is bringing back this resentment. And this is something that is very pernicious. On the other hand, of course, given the question that Michael asked us on the impact of NAFTA, that is something that we praise a lot and we feel that has been, in general, positive for Mexico, plus the issue of immigration. He says he's going to deport 11 million. Yes, let me tell you something. Out of the 11 million or 11.5 million undocumented, half of them are from Mexico, to be more precise, 5.8%. But everybody thinks that the 12 million are from Mexico. And now we have the statistics from Homeland Security or from what countries they are coming. And believe it or not, there is a good number of people from East Europe that are as undocumented as is a Mexican crossing the border. Why? Because for the last 30 years, there hasn't been any kind of reform that allows these people to be legal in the United States. So the effect of Trump has a lot of different impacts, let's say, because of that. What is happening? Well, we are very respectful. We try not to get involved into local politics. But we are preparing, in our case, the two extreme scenarios. What happens if, and what happens if, right? So which are totally different. And with the 50 consulates that we have in the United States, we are ready to go one way or the other way.
Roberta, so how has Donald Trump and his visit, how has it complicated your life representing the United States in Mexico?
I thought about just hiding till November 9th. I really did. I thought maybe I'll just stay home till November 9th. But I didn't. It's been very difficult at times because honestly, the biggest reaction across the board has been, you know, what is happening in your country? This is not, and this is really from Mexicans of all classes, people who know the United States well and those who don't. But the truth is, even those who have never been to the United States know people in the United States and have a better understanding of the U.S., if you will, than most Americans do of Mexico. So the overwhelming universal reaction to the Trump visit itself, and even to a lot in the election campaign, has been what the, you know, what is, but the more concerning response, the much deeper response has been, we're afraid it won't go back to normal after this, that it can't. That such ugly things have been said, and that so many people in the United States could believe them, that it can't go back to normal. And that is much more of concern to me, and it's much more concerning to Mexicans. How can so many people believe things that are patently false, let alone so ugly? And what can we do to get past it? Now, I will tell you, and I've said this publicly elsewhere, one of the things that concerns me is the number of Mexican business people and others that I've talked to who are wringing their hands and very unhappy and who've done absolutely nothing about it. Nothing to publicize the real Mexico, nothing to publicize the benefit of the relationship, nothing to talk about more publicly their own investment in the United States and the jobs they've created. And I'm sorry, they just have to get off their butts and do more too. Because this is shared. And that is not a blame question. That's simply that we have to be working together to overcome this. Because I view my job as trying to bring some truth to this, as I'm not sure I can reassure people about going back to the way it was, but I am trying to sort of clarify and illuminate the relationship and the benefits of the relationship. And I hope that we can do more of that, and that's really what Carlos does every single day in the United States. But I also think there are a lot of good things going on. There, you know, the best ambassadors that we have are the students from Mexico who are studying in the United States. I want to focus a lot on education. Just so you know, there are more U.S. students in Costa Rica than there are in Mexico studying right now. That should be a worry for us. So we're going to be working on that. The other thing I will say, and many people have heard me say this too, is there's a video, there are others that are really good, but there's one that I like because it actually starts with the Mexicans having your back issue and the security issue, which I actually think is more compelling for Americans than some others, by a young guy in Mexico who has a firm called Mexico Imagen, I think, called Agustin Gomez Barrio, Barrios Gomez, which you can find online called The Truth About Us, all one word, thetruthaboutus.org, which is actually pretty good in outlining the case about the relationship, both from security and economic perspective.
Final comment on your question. We are very concerned of what is happening after the election, no matter who wins.
Right.
The damage has already been done, unfortunately. Yep. So we have to double our efforts in order to repave the relationship between Mexico and the United States. So it's going to be very critical, and we are indeed very preoccupied and concerned of what is going to be the consequence in the years to come because of that.
Abe, I promised you a question. Yes, sir.
First, congratulations, Michael and Jerry and the board on the Mexico Initiative. Welcome to good friends. Drawing on what Roberta said about mindsets and habits of cooperation and the time it takes, she mentioned the Plan Colombia and so on, and on what Carlos Manuel said about the Mexico southern border, the question I wanted to ask is this. Mexico and the United States have so many common and shared interests, problems to avoid and opportunities to seize. One of those that doesn't get that much talk, I think, is to look beyond Mexico-US in isolation and look at the Caribbean, Central American region, which also is undergoing all sorts of changes with what's happened in Cuba that Roberta was involved in, with what's happening in Puerto Rico, which should concern us much more than it does with the Northern Triangle and the issues there. Are there ways, assuming the best out of our electoral situation, are there ways, looking forward, to broaden the lens a little bit and think about how to improve the conditions of economic, social, security aspects in the Caribbean, Central American, and Mexican region, the closest neighbors of the United States.
Yeah,
go ahead, Roberta.
There absolutely are, and it's a really good question, Abe. Two things, I think. First of all, Mexico and the U.S. have been talking about and collaborating on, as we call it, and the Mexicans really do, and we've adopted it, really working more on Mesoamerica, really collaborating sort of from Colombia to the U.S.-Mexican border. And that means really focusing on things like pipelines and electrical interconnectivity. It means focusing on climate issues, where you've got 3 million people who are food insecure in Guatemala because of drought, for example. And so we recognize that this is really much, much broader. And in fact, on the migration issue, as you say, in terms of commonalities, Vice President Biden, at one of the first migration meetings he went to, when Secretary Osorio Chong of the Interior Ministry commented, the minute he sat down, the Vice President turned to me and said, "That guy sounds just like me." Because Mexico's challenges sound very much like the U.S. challenges at this point as a transit country and often a receiving country. I also think that when you look at North America as a whole, Mexico's interest in working in the Caribbean in terms of the islands of the Caribbean is, it's present, but it's not as active, right? And they don't necessarily have the resources. Canada's interests in the Caribbean are fairly extensive, both because of Haiti and because they've been in Cuba a long time. And I think that's where we can sort of all play to our strengths, and that North America in general ought to be looking at the Caribbean, at the Caribbean basin writ large, Central America, the Caribbean, and working as a North American unit.
Great. Carlos, very quickly, if you get what I'm told, we have to wrap up.
Yes, as I said, well, we are referring mainly to the relationship with Mexico and the U.S., but for instance, we just had the summit in Canada, the two presidents and the prime minister. And one of the issues, one of the four pillars, it is regional cooperation, security, of course. And Mexico is every day much more involved into that because it is crucial for our interests. These gas pipelines that Roberta was referring to, one of them is going from Salina Cruz to Tapachula in order to go into Guatemala, or the connection of the electric grid from Mexico to the rest of Central America with the idea of generating the conditions for giving employment to the people there. So the regional approach, it is every day more in the table of negotiations between the two of us. That's why when we think as a region, it is, of course, Mexico, United States, and Mexico, but also the Caribbean.
And just, you know, we didn't talk about the high-level economic dialogue, but the new HLED really, in addition to focusing on the bilateral relationship, the third pillar is all about partnering for global leadership and hemispheric leadership, which is a big part of that. We're out of time, regrettably. We could have gone, I think, easy 2 hours on this. And we didn't even scratch the surface. We didn't talk about some of the challenges in Mexico, rule of law issues, the North America situation, the new prime minister, Trudeau. We didn't talk about El Chapo, a new prime minister.
What's
a new prime
talk
minister
about?
In Canada, which is... But here's the point. As we wrap up, I hope at least this has given you a little more insight into what is a very complex relationship, a country that is currently, depending on how you measure it, a G11 nation that's well on its way within many of our lifetimes, I think, to being probably a G7 and beyond, a powerhouse really at the southern end of our country that we need to understand and deal with much more, much better than we do. I want to thank you. Please join me in thanking Ambassador Jacobson and Ambassador Sada.
Just before we go, I really would like to have all of you as our partners in order to promote what is happening in our region and how crucial it is for us to see it from that perspective. It is not Mexico, it is the United States, it is us working together. But we need to have voices like you that have your inner circles, that have your area of influence, that really could help a lot. It is not just the governments.
Right.
It is everybody that really has to see and foresee what is at stake if we do not really connect with what is happening in the region for the benefit of the two countries and a lot of people.
Well said. Thank you very much, panelists.